You are listening to Christian Audio's production of Eight Women of Faith by Michael A.G. Haykin. This book is read by Jim Denison. This audio recording was produced in 2016 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition published by Christian Audio under an agreement with Good News Publishers Crossway Books and Bibles, based on Eight Women of Faith, copyright 2016, Michael A.G. Haykin, all rights reserved. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, King James Version. Forward. Genesis chapter 2 tells us that God created a garden with every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. Verse 9. God told Adam to eat freely of every tree, except one. But rather than focusing on the abundance God had offered freely, Adam and Eve turned their focus on the single thing that was off limits. And the rest is human history. Both within the church and outside it, we too have treated in a similar fashion the biblical admonition against women preaching. We focus on the single thing that is off limits and thereby fail to see the abundant opportunities and roles God has clearly offered, some of which are compellingly portrayed in the stories presented in this book. Likewise, the biblical admonition has led too often to extra-biblical limitations on women, as well as unbiblical oppression, also reflected in the societal restraints these eight women experienced during their lives. This kind of failure toward women, unjustly imposed limitations on their personhood and soul equality, has sometimes led to a secondary failure. The failure to see and tell women's stories clearly, truthfully, and well. Thus, there exists an abundance of works on the lives of women in the church that present readers with unrealistic saints, not flesh and blood women. Such accounts make good fairy tales, but not just or suitable examples of the true life of faith. On the other hand, much of today's retrospectives on women in history tend to focus, understandably and sometimes rightly, on limitations placed on women. Women have been and still are denied much, both in the church and in the culture at large. This book's snapshots of a mere eight women from a mere two centuries offer an astonishing array of roles and achievements by women in a time when women were not so much second-class citizens as not citizens at all. Yet despite, and perhaps because of, such obstacles, what women have contributed and accomplished is rich and varied. Here in these pages, we meet queen, wife, theologian, hymnist, novelist, missionary, daughter, and friend. Even more importantly, we meet women of faith whose lives manifested the grace and glory of God through their faithful obedience to the roles to which they were called, whether in singleness or marriage, in sickness or in health, in riches or in poverty, and ultimately, in death. The facets of womanhood represented in Eight Women of Faith shine brilliantly. This abundance is particularly striking within the early modern era represented by the lives detailed here. The period hinges on a significant turning point in both human history and church history, the Protestant Reformation. The Reformation's emphasis on faith alone and Scripture alone gave birth to the modern individual, and thus the evangelical tradition. And it is the lives of women that most clearly reflect the dramatic historical shifts that took place as a result. It's women of faith, particularly evangelical faith, with its emphasis on individual salvation, who mirror most clearly this great shift in human history and culture that elevated human agency and equality. These developments drew me to my own study of an evangelical woman of this era, Hannah Moore, the British poet, abolitionist, and reformer of the late 18th and early 19th centuries. and they drew me to this fascinating work as well. The portraits Haykin paints of these wildly different women reduce them neither to their roles nor to their religion, but rather show how their faith informed, shaped, and fulfilled their earthly callings. Furthermore, regardless of their relationships to men, single, married, wife, daughter, mother, the women are presented as individuals in their own right, as influenced as they are influential in the roles they fill. Margaret Baxter and Sarah Edwards, for example, are shown as faithful servants of the gospel who are as much served by as servants to their respective husbands, Richard Baxter and Jonathan Edwards. The theology embodied by the written works of Anne Dutton, Anne Steele, and Jane Austen models the abundance in God's garden. We can obey the command not to eat the forbidden fruit and still enjoy a feast abundant enough to nourish all of the faithful. The lives here demonstrate the truth of Jane Austen's words, applicable to men and women equally, that Christians should be up and doing something in the world. The women in this book, each in her own way, did just that. After reading about them, you will want to, too. Karen Swallow Pryor, Liberty University, Virginia. Introduction. The word feminism first appeared in the English language in the late 19th century, yet debates about the role and status of women in society had been going on for a considerable period of time before that. Take, for example, the historical era of the British Civil Wars, 1638 to 1651, and the Republican government of the Puritan Oliver Cromwell, 1599 to 1658, that followed these wars in the 1650s. It's a period of history that has been well described as a world turned upside down. Questions were raised about so much that had been taken for granted, and among these questions were ones about the role of women. The Quakers and women preachers. The Quakers, for example, who emerged as a potent force in the 1650s, proclaimed that there were no spiritual differences between men and women, and therefore there should be no distinction in ministry. Margaret Fell, 1614 to 1702, wife of the Quaker leader George Fox, 1624 to 1691, asserted her right to preach in her best-known work, Women's Speaking, Justified, Proved, and Allowed of by the Scriptures, London, 1666, as did a few other Quaker women in the 1640s and 1650s, like Elizabeth Fletcher, circa 1638 to 1658, in Oxford, and Martha Simmons in London, and this sometimes against Quaker male leadership. Jacqueline Broad has noted that Margaret Fell's arguments in favor of female preaching rest on a principle of spiritual equality, or the idea that both men and women have the supernatural light of Christ within them. But for Fell, the ability to hearken to that light implicitly requires that women possess a natural capacity to discern the truth for themselves, to exercise strength of will, and to exhibit moral virtue or excellence of character. In these respects, Fell's arguments for female preaching contain an implicit feminist challenge to negative perceptions about women's moral and intellectual abilities in her time. Puritan response to Quaker views about women preachers. This brief discussion of the Quakers is significant, for Quaker women preachers reinforced in the minds of more mainstream Puritans, like the Baptists, that having female preachers was definitely wrong. In 1645, before the emergence of the Quakers, when representatives of the Calvinistic Baptist churches in what is known as the Western Association met, the question was asked whether a woman could speak in the church. The reply was clear. A woman is not permitted to speak at all in the church, neither by way of praying, prophesying, inquiring. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 34 and following, and 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 11 and following. The same question was raised 10 or so years later, after the Quaker movement had begun. This time, it was the Midland Association where the question was asked. The same answer was basically given, along with the reason for women's silence, the inferiority of their sex, and to prevent any usurping of authority over men. Nevertheless, five exceptions were given when a woman could speak in church. 1. to publicly give a testimony of conversion when seeking baptism and church membership. 2. To give a report if she had been involved in seeking the restoration of a wayward church member. 3. If she had been sent with a message from another congregation. Are they thinking of Phoebe here? Romans chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. 4. If she needed the church's help and had to lay out that need before the church. 5. If she had been disfellowshipped because of sin and was seeking forgiveness by the congregation and reconciliation. Women essential to Puritan nonconformity. Despite these restrictions, in mainstream Puritan groups, Baptists, as well as Congregationalists and Presbyterians, women did play critical roles in two key areas. First, they played a critical role in teaching children and servants in the home, in accord with the marginal note in the Geneva Bible's rendering of Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 18. It is the mother's duty also to instruct her children. Proponents of the state church feared this Puritan emphasis on the family as a school of piety, for, in their minds, it weakened the parish church. Then, in opening their homes to Puritan ministers, women often played a key role in the establishment of Puritan congregations. For example, Mrs. Dorothy Hazard, died 1675, seceded from the parish church of her husband, Matthew Hazard, in 1640, to establish what later became Broadmead Baptist Church. The church actually began with Hazard and four men meeting in the Hazard home, which of course was also the home of the parish minister. Within 3 years, the church had 160 members. Not surprisingly, this congregation also appointed deaconesses in the 1660s and 1670s. The first deaconess to be appointed was Mary West in 1662. After her death, she was replaced in 1673 by a Sister Murray, and by 1679, three more women had been appointed. Following 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 9, these women were required to be widows over the age of 60 who agreed not to pursue remarriage. They were to take care of the physical needs of the sick in the congregation and be ready to speak a word to their souls as occasion requires. As Patricia Crawford rightly concludes, women were essential to nonconformity, both its emergence and its growth. The Apostle Paul and the Modern Day. The key roles that women played in the advance of Puritan and nonconformist congregations have strong biblical precedent. For instance, a close reading of Romans chapter 16, verses 1 through 16, reveals the truth of the remark by Roger Gryson that there is no doubt that Paul was the beneficiary of numerous instances of assistance from women in his work as an apostle. Of the 27 believers mentioned here in Romans chapter 16, 10 of them are women, with a number of them being commended for their hard work in the Lord. Mary, verse 6, Tryphena and Tryphosa, verse 12, Persis, verse 12, and others being especially recognized for their help to Paul. Phoebe, verses 1 and 2, Priscilla, verses 3 and 4, Rufus's mother, verse 13. Paul's remarks in this chapter of Romans have to be viewed against the cultural milieu of his day that frequently disparaged women. Today, thankfully, the misogynistic trends of certain areas of Western culture have been challenged, and the issues that Christians face in this regard are somewhat different from those of Paul. A strong feminist movement in Western culture has effectively produced a crisis of masculinity in many areas of Western thinking. From the disparagement of women, our culture has swung in many respects to the opposite extreme, the disparagement of men. And in the midst of this, the church needs to be found faithful to the biblical witness. In a culture being swamped by a tsunami of feminism, the great danger for the church is to have a knee-jerk reaction and fail to appreciate what the apostolic generation and our Puritan and nonconformist forebears knew: the vital importance of women for the life of the church. The genesis and nature of this book. This book, really an extended essay comprising 8 different historical and textual vignettes, seeks to remind contemporary Christians, especially evangelicals, of the vital role that women have played in the history of our faith. Although I began lecturing in the 1990s on women in church history, The immediate inspiration for this book lies in a suggestion made to me by my good friend, Jim Frazier, a high school teacher on the Simcoe County School Board, during a week that I was teaching at Muskoka Bible Center, Ontario, in the summer of 2013. He pointed out that Eric Metaxas had just brought out his Seven Men and the Secret of Their Greatness, and that I should do a comparable book on women. I was eager to follow up on this suggestion, as I recognize the real need for such a book in the life of the church. I'm very thankful for Jim's ongoing encouragement of my writing on this topic. I had come across past books, such as Samuel Birder's Memoirs of Eminently Pious Women of the British Empire, 1823, a three-volume expansion of an earlier volume by Thomas Gibbons that had first been published in 1777. But books like this were long out of print. Much more recently, Jamie Yonish wrote When Others Shuddered, Eight Women Who Refused to Give Up, which focuses on eight 19th-century figures. In many ways, I felt that earlier centuries, especially the 18th century, were critical to investigate, especially due to the fact that it was in the 18th century that Western culture launched into the brave new project of reconfiguring society entirely on the basis of human reason and experience. How did Christian women in that era respond to the challenges around them? The book that you are listening to is the result of the interplay of these past events and suggestions. Along the way, I've been privileged to teach some of this material not only in my classes at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, but also in one-day conferences at Calvary Baptist Church of Lenexa, Kansas, thanks to Pastor Brian Albert especially, and Emmanuel Baptist Church, Otisville, Michigan, thanks to Pastor Leroy Cole. A good portion of these chapters was also given in morning sessions of a Bible week at the Muskoka Bible Center in the summer of 2014, and I am deeply grateful to John Friesen, CEO of the center, for the opportunity to do this, and for all of the MBC staff who helped facilitate this. Finally, I'm very thankful also to Linda Reed for the invitation to co-teach a course, The Great Women of the Christian Faith, this past June at Heritage Theological Seminary, which helped me to focus the chapters of this book. In some ways, the book falls into two parts. The first two chapters, those on Lady Jane Grey and Margaret Charlton Baxter, explore women's lives in the church prior to the significant changes of the 18th century. Jane speaks of the way that women made the faith of the Reformation their own, and Margaret shows how women helped men in ministry, in this case her husband, Richard Baxter. I explore these themes by looking at certain written texts, either by the two women or about them. The next six chapters then constitute a prolonged essay on what it was like to be a Christian woman in the 18th century, and written texts again play a central role in the chapters. Anne Dutton, a highly competent theological author, helped serve as a spiritual guide through her books. Sarah Edwards, who left virtually no print footstep, nonetheless reveals the way some Christian women have had profound experiences of God for the blessing of the church. Anne Steele is a pioneer of women hymn writers in which women help the church worship through song and melody. The Diary of Esther Edwards Burr, the daughter of Sarah Edwards, is a fabulous window on the vista of Christian friendship, a long-neglected area of Christian living. Anne Judson was a pioneer missionary with her husband and became something of an icon for generations of women missionaries who followed her. And finally, there's a chapter on Jane Austen, far and away the most famous of all the women in this book, who was also a serious Christian, though this is not often remembered. May the Holy Spirit be pleased to use this book for the good of both men and women in the Church of the Lord Jesus. Dundas, Ontario, July 31, 2015. Chapter 1. The Witness of Jane Grey, an Evangelical Queen. Faith Only Justifieth. It is February 10 in the year 1554. We're in a room in the Tower of London where the Lady Jane Grey, 1537 to 1554, who had been Queen of England for little over a week the previous year, from July 10 through 19, 1553, is imprisoned. She has been condemned to death by her cousin, Mary I, 1516 to 1558, also known to history as Bloody Mary. Though Mary, a diehard Roman Catholic, is determined to end Jane's earthly life, Mary also wants to save Jane's soul. So she has sent one of her most able chaplains, a Benedictine monk by the name of John Feckenham, circa 1515 to 1584, to speak to Jane and convince her of her theological errors. Feckenham was no stranger to theological debate, since he had debated a number of leading Protestant theologians in the early 1550s, men such as John Hooper, 1500 to 1555, and John Jewell, 1522 to 1571. He may well have thought that a young woman such as Jane would be hard-pressed to withstand the power of his reasoning. Jane recorded the conversation after Feckenham left her. According to Jane's account, and we don't have a similar account from Feckenham, though there seems no reason to doubt the veracity of Jane's recollection, after Jane had confessed her faith in the triunity of God, she affirmed that people are saved by faith alone. Feckenham responded to this by citing 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 2, "If I have all faith, but have not love, I am nothing." In other words, Feckenham was maintaining that salvation was the result of both faith and love shown by good works. Jane stood her ground. Jane. "True it is, for how can I love him in whom I trust not? Or how can I trust in him whom I love not? Faith and love agreeth both together, and yet love is comprehended in faith." Feckenham. "How shall we love our neighbor?" Jane. "To love our neighbor is to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and give drink to the thirsty, and to do to him as we would do to ourselves." Feckenham. "Why, then it's necessary to salvation to do good works, and it's not sufficient to believe." Jane. "I deny that, and I affirm that faith only saves. But it is meet for Christians, in token that they follow their Master Christ, to do good works. Yet may we not say that they profit to salvation. For although we have all done all that we can, yet we be unprofitable servants. And the faith only in Christ's blood saveth." Who was this remarkable young woman, and how did she come to be in this precarious position in the infamous Tower of London? In some ways, Jane's story is a difficult one to tell, since it cannot be understood without due consideration of the politics swirling her life. So, as we remember her story, while our focus is going to be on her Christian faith, the political scene cannot be ignored. Jane was the granddaughter of Henry VIII's, 1491 to 1547, youngest and favorite sister, Mary Tudor, 1496 to 1533, and was thus that wily monarch's great niece. During Jane's life, she stood fourth in line to the English throne after Henry's three children, Edward VI, 1537 to 1553, Mary and Elizabeth, 1533 to 1603, and was elevated to the crown after the death of her cousin Edward VI in 1553. Thus, any consideration of Jane's life inevitably involves looking at the politics of the day. Jane's early days. Jane Grey was born to Henry Grey, 1517 to 1554, the Marquis of Dorset, and his wife Frances, 1517 to 1559, the niece of Henry VIII, at their palatial Leicestershire home, Bradgate Manor, early in October 1537. She appears to have been named after the Queen of the day, Jane Seymour, circa 1508 to 1537, the third wife of Henry VIII, and the mother of the future Edward VI. Jane's parents were highly ambitious, callous individuals who balked at nothing to get ahead. They initially hoped that they could marry Jane off to Henry VIII's only son, Edward, who had been born in the same month as Jane. Thus, Jane's parents imposed on her a rigid system of education, requiring her to master Latin, Greek, French, and Italian so as to make her attractive to the future monarch. In 1546, when Jane was nine, she was sent to Henry's court to live under the guardianship of Queen Catherine Parr, 1512 to 1548, the sixth and final wife of Henry VIII. All of this was part of her parents' selfish scheme to marry her to Edward and so advance their standing in society. But in the providence of God, this led to Jane's coming under the influence of Catherine Parr, one of the most charming and intelligent women of the day, a woman who, moreover, was a genuine Christian. In the words of one of her chaplains, "Her rare goodness has made every day a Sunday." It appears to have been the case that it was during this stay in the household of Queen Catherine that Jane came to a living faith in Christ. As Paul Zoll has noted, Catherine was Jane's real mother in Christianity. In 1547, though, Catherine Parr was widowed as Henry VIII died, and as a result, Jane soon returned to her parents' home. Henry was succeeded by his son Edward, who was crowned Edward VI on February 20, 1547. But he was 9 years of age. Yet he was surrounded by a number of godly counselors, including Thomas Cranmer, 1489 to 1556, the Archbishop of Canterbury, who was determined to make England a bastion of the Reformed faith. The great French reformer, John Calvin, 1509 to 1564, actually wrote a letter to Edward's guardian, his uncle, Edward Seymour, circa 1500 to 1552, in which he likened Edward VI to King Josiah. And in time, the young English monarch was indeed like Josiah, eager to have his subjects learn biblical truth. Of 100 or so extant treatises from Edward's hand, a number clearly evidence Edward's commitment to the evangelical faith. When Jane returned to her parents' home in Bradgate, they seemed to have considered her a symbol of failure and a wasted effort, and they treated her accordingly. Jane's response was to pour herself into her studies. She began to excel in Greek, and even entered into correspondence with such continental reformers as Martin Bucer, 1491 to 1551, then living in Cambridge, and Heinrich Bullinger, 1504 to 1575, of Zurich. She was growing in grace and becoming articulate in her faith, though there's also evidence that she was strong-minded and at times displayed a very stubborn streak like many of her Tudor relatives. Marriage and Edward's death. In the spring of 1552, King Edward had the measles, and, not taking time to recover, he soon began to show symptoms of tuberculosis. As the year wore on, it became increasingly clear to those who were close to the king that he would not reach adulthood. Now, Henry VIII's will had named his daughter Mary as next in line to the throne. If Edward didn't marry and produce an heir, a Catholic would rule England. Edward's chief minister, John Dudley, 1504 to 1553, the Duke of Northumberland, well knew that he would be punished by Mary for his support of the Protestant cause. He began to seek a way to prevent her being queen. Jane Grey was fourth in line to the throne and represented, for Northumberland, his only real chance to retain the power and status he had attained. He thus began to foster a close association with Henry and Francis Grey, and in due time convinced them to wed their daughter Jane to his son Guilford Dudley, 1535 to 1554. Early in May 1553, Jane was told by her parents that she was to be married to Guildford. Though Jane protested and utterly refused, for she despised Guildford, it was ultimately to no avail. After her father had sworn at her and cursed her, and her mother had given her an awful beating, she relented. So it was that on May 25th, 1553, Jane...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.